Justified tenors or flows the measure. Those his goodly eyes that o'er the files and musters of the war have glowed like plated Mars now bend. Now turn the office and devotion of their view upon a tawny front. His captain's heart, which o'er the scuffles of great fights has burst the buckles of his breast, reneges all temper and has become the bellows and the fan to cool a gypsy's lust. Look where they come. Take but good notice, and you shall see in him the triple pillar of the world, transformed into a strumpet's fool. Behold and see.
If it be love, indeed, tell me how much.
There's beggary in the love that can be reckoned.
I'll set a bourne how far to be beloved.
Then must thou needs find out new heaven, new earth.
News, my good lord, from Rome.
Greats me. The sum.
Nay, hear them, Antony. Fulvia, perchance, is angry. Or who knows if the scarce-bearded Caesar hath not sent his powerful mandate to you? Do this or this, take in that kingdom or enfranchise that, performed, or else we damn thee.
How, my love?
Perchance, nay, and most like. Oh, you must not stay here longer. Your dismission is come from Caesar, therefore hear them, Antony. Where's Fulvia's process? Caesar's, I would say. Both? Call in the messengers. Oh, as Egypt's queen, thou blushest, Antony, and that blood of thine is Caesar's homager, else so thy cheek pays shame when shrill-tongued Fulvia scolds. The messengers!
Let Rome in Tiber melt, and the wide arch of the ranged empire fall. Here is my space. Kingdoms are clay, our dungy earth alike feeds beast as man. The nobleness of life is to do thus. When such a mutual pair and such a twain can do it, in which I bind on pain of punishment the world to wit, we stand up peerless.
Excellent falsehood. Why did he marry Fulvia and not love her? I'll seem the fool I am not. Antony will be himself.
But stirred by Cleopatra. Now for the love of love and her soft hours, let's not confound the time with conference harsh. There's not a minute of our lives should stretch without some pleasure now. What sport tonight?
Hear the ambassador.
Fire wrangling queen, whom everything becomes. To laugh, to chide, to weep. Whose every passion fully strives to make itself in thee fair and admired. No messenger but thine. And all alone tonight we'll wander through the streets and note the qualities of people. Come, my queen. Last night you did desire it. Speak not to us.
Caesar with Antonius' prize so slight?
Sir, sometimes when he is not Antony, he comes too short of that great property which still should go with Antony.
Oh, I am full sorry that he approves a common liar who thus speaks of him at Rome. But I will hope of better deeds tomorrow. Rest your head.
Lord Alexis, sweet Alexis, most anything Alexis, almost most absolute Alexis, where's the soothsayer that you praise so to the queen? Oh, that I knew this husband, which you say must charge his horns with garlands.
Soothsayer,
your will.
Is this the man? Is you, sir, that know things?
In nature's infinite book of secrecy, a little I can read.
Show him your hand.
Good, sir, give me good fortune.
I make not, but foresee.
Pray then, foresee me one.
You shall be yet far fairer than you are.
He means in flesh.
No, you shall paint when you are old.
Wrinkles forbid.
Vex not his prescience. Be attentive.
You shall be more beloving than beloved.
I had rather heat my liver with drinking.
Nay, hear him.
Good now, some excellent fortune. Let me be married to 3 kings in a forenoon and widow them all. Let me have a child at 50 to whom Herod of Jewry may do homage. Find me to marry with Octavius Caesar, and companion me with my mistress.
You shall outlive the lady whom you serve.
Oh, excellent! I love long life better than figs.
You have seen and proved a fairer former fortune than that which is to approach.
Then belike my children shall have no names. Prithee, How many boys and wenches must I have?
If every of your wishes had a womb, then fertile every wish, a million.
Out, fool! I forgive thee for a witch.
You think none but your sheets are privy to your wishes?
Nay! Come, tell Iris hers.
We'll know all our fortunes.
Mine and most of our fortunes tonight will be drunk to bed.
There's a palm presages chastity, if nothing else.
E'en as the flowing Nilus presageth famine.
Go, you wild bedfellow, you cannot soothsay.
Nay, if an oily palm be not a fruitful prognostication, I cannot scratch mine ear. Prithee, tell her but a workaday fortune.
Your fortunes are alike.
But how? Give me particulars.
I have said.
Am I not an inch of fortune better than she?
Well, if you were but an inch of fortune better than I, where would you choose it?
Not in my husband's nose.
A worse thought, heaven's man. Alexis, come. His fortune, his fortune.
Oh, let him marry a woman that cannot go, sweet Isis. I beseech thee. And let her die, too. And give him a worse. And let worse follow worse, till the worst of all follow him, laughing to his grave, 50-fold a cuckold. Good Isis, hear me this prayer. Though thou deny me a measure of more weight, good Isis, I beseech thee.
Amen. Dear goddess, hear that prayer of the people. For it is heartbreaking to see a handsome man loose wived, so it is a deadly sorrow to see a foul knave uncuckold. Therefore, sweet Isis, keep decorum and fortune him accordingly.
Amen.
Lo now, if it lay in their hands to make me a cuckold, they'd make themselves whores, but they do it.
Here comes Antony.
Not he, the queen.
Saw you, my lord?
No, lady.
Was he not here?
No, madam.
He was disposed to mirth, but on the sudden a Roman thought hath struck him. Enobarbus?
Madam.
Seek him and bring him hither. Where's Alexis?
Here at your service. See, my lord approaches.
We will not look upon him. Go with us.
If only thy wife first came into the field.
Against my brother Lucius?
Aye, but soon that war had end, and time state made friends of them, joining their force against Caesar, whose better issue in the war from Italy upon the first encounter drave them.
Well, what worst?
The nature of bad news infects the teller.
When it concerns the fool or coward, on! Things that are past are done with me. 'Tis thus. Who tells me true, though in his tale lie death, I hear him as he flattered.
Labienus, this is stiff news, hath with his Parthian force extended Asia from Euphrates. His conquering banner shook from Syria to Lydia to Ionia, whilst...
Antony, thou would say?
Oh, my lord.
Speak to me, home, mince not the general tongue. Name Cleopatra, she is called in Rome. Rail thou in Fulvia's phrase, and taunt my faults with such full license as both truth and malice have power to utter.
Fulvia, thy wife, is dead.
Where died she?
In Sicca. Her length of sickness, with what else more serious importeth thee to know, this bears.
Forbear me. There's a great spirit gone. Thus did I desire it. She's good being gone. The hand could pluck her back that shoved her on. I must from this enchanting queen break off 10,000 harms, more than the ills I know my idleness doth etch.
Anaya Nebarbus.
What's your pleasure, sir?
I must with haste from hence.
Well, then we kill all our women.
We see how mortal an unkindness is to them. If they suffer our departure, death's the word. I must be gone.
Upon a compelling occasion, let women die. It were a pity to cast them away for nothing, though between them and a great cause they should be esteemed nothing.
Cleopatra, catching but the least noise of this, dies instantly. I've seen her die 20 times upon far poorer moment. I do think there is metal in death which commits some loving act upon her. She hath such a celerity in dying. She is cunning, past man's thought.
Oh, alack, sir, no. Her passions are made of nothing but the finest part of pure love. We cannot call her winds and waters, sighs and tears. They are greater storms and tempests than almanacs can report. This cannot be cunning in her. If it be, she makes a shower of rain as well as Jove.
Would I had never seen her?
Oh, sir, then you had left unseen a wonderful piece of work, which not to have been blessed with all would have discredited your travel.
Fulvia is dead.
Sir?
Fulvia is dead.
Fulvia?
Dead.
Well, then, sir, give the gods a thankful sacrifice. There were no other women but Fulvia. Then had you indeed a cut in the case to be lamented. This grief is crowned with consolation. Your old smock brings forth a new petticoat. And indeed, the tears live in an onion that should water this, sir.
The business she hath broached in this state cannot endure my absence.
And the business that you have broached here cannot be without you. especially that of Cleopatra's, which wholly depends on your abode.
No more light answers. Let our officers have noticed what we purpose. I shall break the cause of our expedience to the queen and get her leave to part. Sextus Pompeius hath given the dare to Caesar and commands the empire of the sea. Our slippery people, whose love is never linked to the deserver till his deserts are past, begin to throw Pompey the Great and all his dignities upon his son, who high in name and power, higher than both in blood and life, stands up for the main soldier, whose quality going on the sides of the world may danger. Say our pleasure to such whose place is under us requires our quick remove from hence.
I shall do it.
Where is he? I did not see him since.
See where he is, who's with him, what he does. I did not send you. You find him sad, say I am dancing. If in mirth that I am sudden sick, quick and return.
Madam, methinks if you did love him dearly, you do not hold the method to enforce the like from him.
What should I do, I do not?
In each thing give him way. Cross him in nothing.
Thou teachest like a fool the way to lose him.
Tempt him not so, too far. But here comes Antony.
I am sick and sullen.
I am sorry to give breathing to my purpose.
Help me away, Carmen, I shall fall.
It cannot be thus long. The sides of nature will not sustain it.
No, my dearest queen.
Already stand further from me.
What's the matter?
I know by that same eye there's some good news. What says the married woman? You may go. But she had never given you leave to come. Let her not think 'tis I that keep you here. I have no power upon you. Hers you are.
The gods best know.
Never was their queen so mightily betrayed. Yet at the first I saw the treasons planted.
Cleopatra!
How can I think you can be mine and true, who have been false to Fulvia?
Hear me, queen.
Then pray you seek no colour for your going, but bid farewell and go. When you sued staying, then was the time for words, no going then. Eternity was in our lips and eyes, bliss in our brows bent, and none apart so poor but was a race of heaven. They are so still. All thou the greatest soldier of the earth, thou turn the greatest liar.
Why, how now?
I would I had thy inches, thou wouldst know they were a heart in Egypt.
Hear me, queen. The strong necessity of time commands our services a while. But my full heart remains in use with you. Our Italy shines o'er with civil swords. Sextus Pompeius makes his approaches to the port of Rome. Quietness, grown sick of rest, would purge by any desperate change. My more particular and that which most with you should save my going is Fulvia's death.
Though age from folly could not give me freedom, it does from childishness. Can Fulvia die?
She's dead, my queen. See when and where she died.
Oh, most false love! Where be these sacred vials thou shouldst fill with sorrowful water? Now I see in Fulvia's death how mine received shall be.
Quarrel no more, but be prepared to know the purposes I bear. I go from hence thy soldier, servant, making peace or war as thou affix'st.
Cut my lace, Carmion, come, but let it be. I am quickly ill and well, so Antony love.
My precious queen, forbear, and give true evidence to his love, which stands an honorable trial.
So Fulvia told me. Prithee, turn aside and weep for her. Then bid adieu to me and say the tears belong to Egypt. Good, now, play one scene of excellent dissembling and let it look like perfect honor.
You make my blood, no more.
Oh, you can do better yet, but this is meatly.
Now by my sword.
And target. Still he mends, but this is not the best. Look, prithee, Carmion, how this Herculean Roman doth become the carriage of his chain.
I leave you, lady.
Courteous lord, one word. Sir, you and I must part. But that's not it. Sir, you and I have loved, but there's not it, that you know well. Something there is, I would. Oh, my oblivion is a very Antony, and I am all forgotten. Your honor calls you hence, therefore be deaf to my unpitied folly, and all the gods go with you. Upon your sword sit laurel victory, and smooth success be strewed before your feet.
Let us go. Come. Our separation so abides and flies that thou residing here goes yet with me, and I, hence fleeting, here remain with thee. Away!
You may feel at this henceforth, no, it is not Caesar's natural vice to hate our great competitor. From Alexandria this is the news. He fishes, drinks, and wastes the lamps of night in revel. He is not more manlike than Cleopatra, nor the queen of Ptolemy more womanly than he. Hardly gave audience or vouchsafe to think he had, Pop.
I must not think there are evils enough to darken all his goodness. His faults in him seem as the spots of heaven, more fiery by night's blackness, hereditary rather than purchased. What he cannot change than what he chooses.
You are too indulgent. Let us grant it is not amiss to tumble on the bed of Ptolemy, to grant a kingdom for a mirth, to sit and keep the turn of Kipling with a slave, to reel the streets at noon and stand the buffet with knaves that smell of sweat. Say this becomes him, as his composure must be rare indeed, whom these things cannot blemish. Yet must that in no way excuse his soils, when we do bear so great weight in his likeness. 'Tis to be chin, as we rate boys, who, being mature in knowledge, pawn their experience to their present pleasure, and so rebel to judgment.
Here's more news. Thy biddings have been done. Pompey is strong at sea, and it appears he is much beloved of those that only have feared Caesar. To the ports the discontents repair, and men's reports give him much wrong.
I should have known no less. It hath been taught us from the primal state that the ebbed man, ne'er loved till ne'er worth love, comes dear'd by being lacked. This common body, like to the vagabond flag upon the stream, goes to and back, lacking the varying tide to rot itself with motion.
Caesar, I bring thee word. Menecrates and Manus, famous pirates, make the sea serve them. Many hot inroads they make in Italy. No vessel may peep forth, but 'tis as soon taken as seen. For Pompey's name strikes more than could his war resist it.
Oh, Antony! Leave thy lascivious wassails. Thou once wast beaten from Modena. At thy heels did famine follow, which thou fought'st against, though daintily brought up, with patience more than savages could suffer. Thou didst drink the stale of horses, and the gilded puddle which beasts would corp at. Thy palate then did deign the roughest berry on the rudest hedge. Yea, like the stag, when snow the pasture sheets, the barks of trees thou browsest. On the Alps it is reported thou didst eat strange flesh, which some did die to look on. And all this, it wounds thine honor that I speak it now. Wast born so like a soldier that thy cheek so much as length not.
'Tis pity of him.
Let his shames drive him quickly to Rome. 'Tis time we twain to show ourselves in the field. To that end assemble we immediate council. Pompey thrives in our idleness.
Tomorrow, Caesar, I shall be furnished to inform you rightly both what by sea and land I can be able to front this present time.
To which encounter it is my business too. Farewell.
Farewell, my lord. What you shall know meantime of stirs abroad, I beseech you, sir, to let me be partaker.
Doubt not, sir. I knew it for my bond.
Come in, madam. Give me to drink mandragora.
Why, madam?
Oh, that I might sleep out this great gap of time my Antony is away.
You think of him too much.
Tis treason.
Madam, I trust not so.
Thou, eunuch Mardian.
What's your highness' pleasure?
Not now to hear thee sing. I take no pleasure in aught a eunuch has. Tis well for thee that, being unseminared, thy freer thoughts may not fly forth of Egypt. Tell me, hast thou affections?
Yes, gracious madam.
Indeed?
Not indeed, for I can do nothing but what indeed is honest to be done. Yet have I fierce affections, and think what Venus did with Mars.
Oh, Carmen, thinkst thou he is now? Stands he or sits he, or does he walk, or is he on his horse? Oh, happy horse to bear the weight of Antony. Do bravely, horse, for what's thou whom thou movest? The demi-atlas of the earth, the almond, virginate of men. Speaking now, or murmuring, where's my serpent of old Nile, for so he calls me. Now I feed myself with the most delicious poison. Think on me, that I'm with Phoebus' amorous pinches black and wrinkled deep in time. Broad-fronted Caesar, when thou wast here above the ground, I was a morsel for a monarch. And great Pompey would stand and make his eyes grow in my brow. There would he anchor his aspect and die with looking on his life.
Sovereign of Egypt, hail!
How much unlike art thou, Mark Antony! Yet coming from him that great medicine hath with his tinct gilded thee. How goes it with my brave Mark Antony?
Last thing he did, dear queen, he kissed the last of many doubled kisses this orient pearl.
His speech sticks in my heart.
Oh, mine ears pluck at hands.
Good friend, quoth he, say the firm Roman to great Egypt sends this treasure of an oyster, at whose foot, to mend the petty present, I will peace her opulent throne with kingdoms. All the East, say thou, shall call her mistress.
What, was he sad or merry?
Like to the time of year betwixt extremes of hot and cold. He was nor sad nor merry.
Oh, well-divided disposition. Note him, good Carmion, tis the man. Met'st thou my post?
Why, madam, 20 several messengers. Why do you send so thick?
Who's born that day I shall forget to send to Antony, shall die a beggar. Quick, get me ink and paper. Welcome, good Alexis. Carmion, did ever I love Caesar so?
Oh, that's brave Caesar.
Be choked with such an emphasis. Say the brave Antony.
The valiant Caesar.
Oh, by Isis, I will give thee bloody teeth if thou with Caesar paragon again, my man of men.
By your most gracious pardon, I sing but after you.
My salad days, when I was green in judgment, cold in blood, to say as I said then. But come away, get me ink and paper. He shall have every day a several greeting, or I'll unpeople Egypt.
If the great gods be just, they shall assist the deeds of justice men.
Know, worthy Pompey, that what they do delay, they not deny.
I shall do well. The people love me, and the sea is mine. My powers are crescent, and my auguring hope says it will come to the full. Mark Antony sits at dinner in Egypt, and will make no wars without doors. Caesar gets money, where he loses hearts. Lepidus flatters both, of both is flattered, yet he neither loves nor either cares for him.
Caesar and Lepidus are in the field. A mighty strength they carry.
Where have you this? 'Tis false.
From Sylvia, sir.
He dreams. I know they are in Rome together, looking for Antony. But all the charms of love, salt Cleopatra, soften thy wand lip. Let witchcraft join with beauty, lust with both. Tie up this libertine in a field of feast. Keep his brain fuming. Epicurean cooks shopping with cloyless sauce his appetite, till sleeping and feeding prorogue his honor, even till a lethe dullness. Oh, now, Varius.
This is most certain that I shall deliver. Mark Antony is every hour in Rome expected. Since he went from Egypt, tis a space for further travel.
I could have given less news a better ear. I did not think, Menas, this amorous surfeiter would have donned his helm for such a petty war. His soldiership is twice the other twain. But let us rear the higher our opinion, that our stirring can from the lap of Egypt's widow pluck the ne'er lust-wearied Antony.
I cannot hope Caesar and Antony shall well greet together. His wife that's dead did trespasses to Caesar. His brother warred on him, although I think not moved by Antony.
I know not, Menas, how lesser enmities give way to greater. Were it not that we stand up against them all, 'twere pregnant they should square between themselves, for they have entertained cause enough to draw their sword. But how the fear of us may cement this action and bind up these petty differences, we yet not know. Be it as our gods will have it. It only stands upon our lives to show our strongest hands. Come, Menas.
Good, Enobardus. 'Tis a worthy deed, and shall become you well to entreat your captain to soft and gentle speech.
I shall entreat him to answer like himself. If Caesar move him, let Antony look over Caesar's head and speak as loud as Mars. By Jupiter, were I the wearer of Antonius' beard, I would not shave today.
'Tis not a time for private stomaching.
Every time serves for the matter that is then born in.
But small to greater matters must give way.
Not if the small come first.
Oh, your speech is passion. But pray you, stir no embers up. Here comes the noble Antony.
And yonder, Caesar.
If we compose well here to Parthia. Ah, Canidius.
I do not know, Messinus. Ask Agrippa.
Noble friends, that which combined us was most great, and let not a leaner action rend us. What's amiss, may it be gently heard. Then, noble partners, the rather for I earnestly beseech, touch you the sourest points with sweetest terms, nor curseness grow to the matter.
'Tis spoken well. Were we before our armies and to fight, I should do thus.
Welcome to Rome.
Thank you.
Sit.
Sit, sir.
Nay, then.
I learn you take things ill which are not so, or being concern you not.
I must be laughed at, if for nothing or a little I should say myself offended, and with you chiefly the world.
My being in Egypt, Caesar, what was to you?
No more than my residing here in Rome might be to you in Egypt. Yet if you there did practice on my state, your being in Egypt might be my question.
How intend you practice?
Your wife and brothers made war upon me, and that contestation was theme for you. You were the word of war.
You do mistake your business. My brother never did urge me in his act. Did he not rather discredit my authority with yours and make the wars alike against my stomach, having alike your cause? Of this before my letters did satisfy you. If you patch a quarrel, it must not be with this.
You praise yourself by laying defects of judgment to me. Yet you patched up your excuses.
Not so, not so. I know you could not lack. I'm certain on it. Very necessity of this thought that I, your partner in the cause against which he fought, could not with graceful eyes attend those wars which fronted mine own peace. As for my wife, I would you had her spirit and such another. The third of the world is yours, which with a snaffle you may pace easy, but not such a wife.
Would we had all such wives, that the men might go to wars with the women?
So much uncurvable, her garboiled Caesar, made out of her impatience. I grieving grant did you too much disquiet. For that, you must but say I could not help it.
I wrote to you while rioting in Alexandria. You did pocket up my letters, and with taunts did jibe my missive out of audience.
Sir, he fell upon me ere admitted. Then three kings I had newly feasted, and did want of what I was in the morning. But next day I told him of myself, which was as much as to have asked him pardon. Let this fellow be nothing in our strife, if we contend out of the question wipe him.
You have broken the article of your oath, which you shall never have tongue to charge me with.
Soft, Caesar.
No, Lepidus. Let him speak. The honor is sacred that he talks on now, supposing that I lacked it. But on, Caesar, the article of my oath.
To lend me arms and aid when I require them, the which you both denied.
Neglected, rather. And then when poisoned hours had bound me up from mine own knowledge. As nearly as I may, I'll play the penitent to you. But mine honesty shall not make poor my greatness, nor my power work without it. Truth is that Fulvia, to have me out of Egypt, made wars here, for which myself, the ignorant motive, do so far ask pardon as befits mine honor to stoop in such a case.
'Tis noble spoken.
If it might please you further, the present need speaks to atone you.
Worthily spoken, Maecenas.
Or if you borrow one another's love for the instant, you may, when you hear no more words of Pompey, return it again. You shall have time to wrangle in when you have nothing else to do.
Thou art a soldier only. Speak no more.
The truth should be silent. I had almost forgot.
You wrong this presence, therefore speak no more.
Well, go to, then. You're considerate stone.
I do not much dislike the matter, but the manner of his speech. For it cannot be that we shall remain in friendship, our conditions so differing in their acts. Yet if I knew what hoop could hold us staunch, from edge to edge of the world I would pursue it.
Give me leave, Caesar.
Speak, Agrippa.
Thou hast a sister by the mother's side, admired Octavia. Great Mark Antony is now a widower.
Oh, say not so, Agrippa. If Cleopatra heard you, your reproof were well deserved of rashness.
I am not married, Caesar. Let me hear Agrippa further speak.
To hold you in perpetual amity, to make you brothers, and to knit your hearts in an unslipping knot, take Antony Octavia to his wife, whose beauty claims no worse a husband than the best of men, whose virtues and whose general graces speak that which none else can utter. By this marriage all little jealousies, which now seem great, would then be nothing. Her love to both would each to other, and all loves to both draw after her. Pardon what I have spoken, for 'tis a studied, not a present thought. By duty ruminated.
Will Caesar speak?
Not till he hears how Antony is touched with what he spoke already.
What power is in Agrippa, if I should say Agrippa be this so, to make it good?
The power of Caesar, and his power unto Octavia.
May I never, to this good purpose that so fairly shows, dream of impediments. Let me have thy hand. Further this act of grace, and from this hour, the heart of brothers govern in our loves, and sway our great designs.
There is my hand. A sister I bequeath you, whom no brother did ever love so dearly. Let her live to join our kingdoms and our hearts.
Happily, amen.
I did not think to draw my sword against Pompey, for he hath laid strange courtesies and great of late upon me. I must thank him, only lest my remembrance suffer ill report, and he'll of that defy him.
Time calls upon us. Of us must Pompey presently be sought, or else he seeks out us.
Where lies he?
About the Mount Messenum.
What is his strength by land?
Great and increasing, but by sea he is an absolute master.
Haste we for it. Yet, ere we put ourselves in arms, dispatch we the business we have talked of.
With most gladness. And do invite you to my sister's view. Whither straight I'll lead you.
Let us, Lepidus, not lack your company.
Noble Antony, not sickness should detain me.
Welcome from Egypt, sir.
Have the heart of Caesar, worthy Maecenas. My honorable friend Agrippa.
Good enough, Bob.
We have cause to be glad that matters are so well digested. You stayed well by it in Egypt.
Aye, sir, we did sleep day out of countenance and made the night light with drinking.
8 wild boars roasted whole at a breakfast and but 12 persons there. Is this true? Oh,
this was but as a fly by an eagle. There was much more monstrous matter of feast, which worthily deserve noting.
She's a most triumphant lady, if report be square to her.
When she first met Mark Antony, she pursed up his heart upon the river of Cydnus.
There she appeared indeed, or my reporter hath devised well for her.
I will tell you. The barge she sat in, like a burnished throne, burned on the water. The poop was beaten gold, purple the sails, and so perfumed that the winds were lovesick with them. The oars were silver, which to the tune of flutes kept stroke, and made the water which they beat to follow faster as amorous of their strokes. For her own person, it beggared all description. She did lie in her pavilion, cloth of gold, of tissue, or picturing that Venus where we see the fancy outwork nature. On each side her stood pretty dimpled boys, like smiling cupids, with divers colored fans, whose wind did seem to glow the delicate cheeks that they did cool, and what they undid, did.
Oh, rare for Antony.
Her gentlewomen, like the Nereides, so many mermaids tended her the eyes and made their bends adornings. At the helm, a seeming mermaid steers. Silken tackle swelled to the touches of those flower-soft hands, which yearly frame the office. From the barge, a strange, invisible perfume hits the sense of the adjacent wharves. The city cast her people out upon her. And Antony, enthroned to the marketplace, did sit alone whistling to the air, which but for vacancy had gone to gaze on Cleopatra too and made a gap in nature.
Rare Egyptian.
Upon her landing, Antony sent to her, invited her to supper. She replied, it should be better he became her guest, which she entreated. Our courteous Antony, whom ne'er the word of no woman heard speak, being barbered 10 times o'er, goes to the feast, and for his ordinary pays his heart for what his eyes eat only.
Royal wench, she made great Caesar lay his sword to bed. He plowed her, and she cropped.
I saw her once hop 40 paces through the public street, and having lost her breath, she spoke and panted that she did make defect perfection and breathless power breathe forth.
And now Antony must leave her utterly.
Never.
He will not.
Age cannot wither her, nor custom stale her infinite variety. Other women cloy the appetites they feed, but she makes hungry where most she satisfies. For vilest things become themselves in her, that the holy priests bless her when she is rich.
If beauty, wisdom, modesty can settle the heart of Antony, Octavia is a blessed lottery to him.
Let us go. Good enough, Barbus. Make yourself my guest whilst we are here.
Lovely, sir. Thank you.
The world and my great office will sometimes divide me from your bosom.
All which time, before the gods, my knees shall bow my prayers to them for you.
Good night, sir. My Octavia, read not my blemish in the world's report. I have not kept my square. But that to come shall all be done by the rule. Good night, dear lady.
Good night, sir.
Good night.
Now, sirrah, you do wish yourself in Egypt.
Would I had never come from thence, nor you thither.
If you can, your reason.
I see it in my motion, have it not in my tongue. But yet hie you to Egypt again.
Say to me, whose fortune shall rise higher, Caesar's or mine?
Caesar's. Therefore, O Antony, stay not by his side. Thy demon, that's thy spirit which keeps thee, is noble, courageous, high. Unmatchable where Caesar's is not. But near him, thy angel becomes a fear as being overpowered. Therefore, make space enough between you.
Speak this no more.
To none but thee. No more but when to thee. If thou dost play with him at any game, thou art sure to lose. And of that natural luck, he beats thee against the odds. Thy luster thickens when he shines by. I say again, thy spirit is all afraid to govern thee near him. But he away, 'tis noble.
Get thee gone. Say to Canidius I would speak with him. He shall to Parthia. Be it art or hap, he hath spoken true. The very dice obey him. In our sports, my better cunning faints under his chance. If we draw lots, he speeds, his cocks to win. I shall to Egypt. And though I make this marriage for my peace, in the east my pleasure lies. Oh, come, Canidius, you shall to Parthia. Your commission's ready. Follow me and receive it.
Give me some music. Music, moody food of us that trade in love.
The music, ho!
Let it alone. That's to billiards. Come, Carmion.
My arm is sore. Best play with Mardian.
As well a woman with an eunuch played as with a woman. Come, sir, you'll play with me?
As well as I can, madam.
And when goodwill is showed, though it come too short, the actor may plead pardon. I'll not now. Give me mine angle, we'll to the river. There, my music playing far off, I will betray tawny thin fishes. My bended hook shall pierce their slimy jaws, and as I draw them up, I'll think them every one an Antony, and say, aha, you're caught.
'Twas merry when you wagered on your angling, when your diver did hang a soft fish on his hook, which he with fervency drew up.
Oh, that time, oh, times I laughed him out of patience. And that night I laughed him into patience. And the next morning, at the ninth hour, I drunk him to his bed and put my tires and mantles on him whilst I wore his sword, Philippine. Oh, from Italy, ran thou thy fruitful tidings in mine ear, which long time have been buried.
Madam, madam.
Antony's dead. Thou sayest so, villain, thou killst thy mistress. But well and free, if thou so yield him, there is gold. And here my bluest veins to kiss. A hand that kings have lipped and trembled kissing.
First, madam, he is well.
There's more gold. But, sirrah, mark, we used to say the dead are well. Bring into that the gold I give thee, will I melt and pour down thy ill-uttering throat.
Good madam, hear me.
Well, go to, I will. But there's no goodness in thy face. If Antony be free and healthful, why so tardy favor do trumpet such good tidings? If not well, thou shouldst come a fury crowned with snakes, not like a formal man.
Will please you hear me?
I don't mind to strike thee ere thou speak'st. Yet if thou say Antony lives, is well, is friends with Caesar are not captive to him, I'll set thee in a shower of gold and hail rich pearls upon thee.
Madam, he's well.
Well said.
And friends with Caesar.
Oh, thou'rt an honest man.
Caesar and he are greater friends than ever.
Make thee a fortune from me.
But yet, madam.
I do not like but yet. Prithee, friend, pour out the pack of matter to mine ear, the good and bad together. He's friends with Caesar in state of health, thou sayest. And thou sayest free?
Free? No, madam, I made no such report. He's bound unto Octavia.
For what good turn?
For the best turn of the bed.
Come in, I'm pale.
Madam, he's married to Octavia.
The most infectious pestilence upon thee!
But, madam, patience!
But you will be whipped with wires, you need rhyme smiting and make green pickles.
Gracious madam, I did you bring the news, made not the match.
It is not so a province I will give thee, will make thy fortunes proud.
He's married, madam.
Rogue, thou hast lived.
Nay, but I'll run. What mean you, madam? I have made no fault.
But, madam, keep yourself within yourself. The man is innocent.
Some innocent state not the sendable.
Melt Egypt into Nile, and kindly creatures turn all to serpents. Call the slave again. Though I am mad, I will not bide him call.
He is afeard to come.
I will not hurt him. These hands do lack nobility, that they strike a meaner than myself, since I myself have given myself the cause. Come hither, sir. Though it be honest, it is never good to bring bad news. Give to a gracious message an host of tongues, but let ill tidings tell themselves when they be felt.
I have done my duty.
Is he married? I cannot hate thee worse than I do if thou again say yes.
He's married, madam.
Gods confound thee, dost thou hold there still?
Should I lie, madam?
I would thou didst, so half my Egypt were submerged and made a cistern for scaled snakes. He is married.
I crave your highness' pardon.
He is married.
To punish me for what you make me do seems much unequal.
He's married. Good, your highness, patience. In praising Antony, I have dispraised Caesar.
Many times, madam.
I am paid for it now. Lead me from hence, I shall fall.
Oh, Iris Carmion. But 'tis no matter. Go to the fellow, good Alexis. Bid him report the feature of Octavia, her years, her inclination. Let him not leave out the color of her hair. Bring me word quickly. Oh, let him forever go. Let him not. Come in the one way he be painted like a Gorgon, the other way's a Mars. Bid you, Alexis, bring me word how tall she is. Pity me, but do not speak to me. Lead me to my chamber.
Hostages I have, so have you mine. And we shall talk before we fight.
Most meet that first we come to words. And therefore have we our written purposes before assent. Which, if you have considered, let us know if 'twill tie up thy discontented sore.
To you all three, the senators alone of this great world, chief factors for the gods. I do not know wherefore my father should revenge his want, having a son and friends. Since Julius Caesar, who at Philippi the good Brutus ghosted, there saw you laboring for him. What was it that moved pale Cassius to conspire? And what made the all-honored, honest Roman Brutus, with the armored rest, courteous of beauteous freedom, who drenched the capital, but that they would have one man, but a man? And that is it hath made me rig my navy, at whose burden the angered ocean foams, with which I meant to scourge the ingratitude that despiteful Rome cast on my noble father.
Take your time.
Thou canst not fear us, Pompey, with thy sails. We'll speak with thee at sea. At land thou knowest how much we do o'ercount thee.
At land indeed. Thou dost o'ercount me of my father's house. But since the cuckoo builds not for himself, remain it as thou mayest.
Be pleased to tell us, for this is from the present, how you take the offers we have sent you.
You have made me offer of Sicily and Sardinia, and I must rid all the sea of pirates, then to send measures of wheat to Rome, escreed upon to part with unhacked edges and bear back our togs undinted.
That's our offer.
No, then. I came before you here a man prepared to take this offer, but Mark Antony put me to some impatience. Though I lose the praise of it by telling, you must know when Caesar and your brother were at blows, your mother came to Sicily and did find her welcome friendly.
I have heard it. And am well studied for a liberal thanks, which I do owe you.
Let me shake thy hand. I did not think, sir, to have met you here.
The beds of the east are soft, thanks to you that called me timelier than my purpose hither, for I have gained by it.
Since I saw you last, there is a change upon you.
Well, I know not what counts harsh fortune cast upon my face, but in my bosom shall she never come to make my heart her vassal.
Well met here.
I hope so, Lepidus.
Us, we are agreed. I crave our composition may be written and sealed between us.
That's the next to do.
We'll feast each other ere we part. But first or last, your fine Egyptian cookery shall have the fame. I have heard that Julius Caesar grew fat with feasting there.
You have heard much?
I have fair meaning, sir.
And fair words to them.
And then so much have I heard. And I have heard Apollodorus carried...
No more of that. He did so.
What, I pray you?
A certain queen to Caesar in a mattress.
I know thee now. How farest thou, soldier?
Well, and well I'm like to do, since I perceive four feasts are toward.
Let me shake thy hand. I have never hated thee. I have seen thee fight when I did envy thy behavior.
Sir, I never loved you much, though I have praised you when you well deserved 10 times what I have said you did.
Enjoy thy plainness, and nothing ill becomes thee. Aboard my galleys, I invite you all.
We will lead, Lord.
Show us the way, sir.
Come.
My father, Pompey, would ne'er have made this treaty. You and I have known, sir.
At sea, I think.
We have, sir.
You've done well by water.
And you by land.
Well, praise any man who will praise me. It cannot be denied what I have done by land.
Nor what I have done by sea.
Yes, something you can deny for your own safety. You've been a great thief by sea.
And you by land.
Oh, there I deny my land service. But give me your hand, Manus. We came hither to fight with you.
For my part, I am sorry it has turned to a drinking. Pompey doth this day laugh away his fortune.
Sure, if he do, he cannot weep it back again.
You've said so. We looked not for Mark Antony here. Pray you, is he married to Cleopatra?
Caesar's sister is called Octavia.
True, sir. She was the wife of Caius Marcellus.
But she is now the wife of Marcus Antonius.
Pray you, sir.
Tis true.
Then is Caesar and he forever knit together?
Oh, if I were bound to divine of this union, I would not prophesy so. You shall find that band which seems to tie their friendship together will prove the very strangler of their amity. Octavia is of a holy, cold, and still conversation.
Why, who would not have his wife so?
Not he that is himself not so, and that's Mark Antony. He will to his Egyptian dish again. Then shall the sighs of Octavia blow up the fire in Caesar. And as I said before, that which is the strength of their amity will prove the immediate author of their variance. Antony will use his affection where it is. He married but his occasion here.
And thus it may be. Come, will you aboard? I have a help for you.
I'll take it, sir. With you, Sir Coates in Egypt.
There they'll be, man. Some of their plants are real rooted already. The least one in the world will floor them.
Lepidus is a high power.
They made him drink a hundred.
As they pitch one another by the disposition, he cries out, no more. Reconciles them to his entreaty and himself to the drink.
But it raises a greater war between him and his discretion.
Thus do they, sir. They take the flow of the Nile by certain scales of the pyramid. And they can tell by the height, the lowness, or the mean, whether dearth or moistened follow. The higher Nile swells, the more it promises. As it ebbs, the seedsman upon the ooze and slime scatters his grain and shortly comes to harvest.
You've strange serpents there.
Hi, Lepidus.
Your serpent of Egypt is bred now of your mud by the operation of your sun. So is your crocodile.
Tis true.
Sit and some wine.
Health to Lepidus.
Lepidus!
I am not so well as I should be. But I'll ne'er out.
Not till you have slept. I fear me you'll be in till then.
Nay, certainly. I've heard that Ptolemy's pyramesis are very goodly things. Without contradiction, I have heard that.
Pompey, a word.
Say in mine ear, what is it?
Forsake thy seat, I do beseech thee, Captain, and hear me speak a word.
Forbear me till anon. This health for
Lepidus!
Lepidus!
What manner of thing is your crocodile?
Oh, it is shaped, sir, like itself. And it is just so broad as it hath breadth. It is as high as it is. It moves with its own organs. It lives by that which nourisheth it. And the elements once out of it, it transmigrates.
What color is it of?
Of its own color, too.
'Tis a strange serpent.
'Tis true. And the tears of it are wet.
Will this description satisfy him?
With the health that Pompey gives him, else he's a very epicure.
Go hang, sir, hang. Tell me of that. Do as I bid you, away.
Where is that cup I call for?
If for the sake of merit thou wilt hear me, rise from thy stool.
I think thou art mad. The matter?
I have ever held my cap off to thy fortunes.
Thou hast served me with much faith. What's else to say? Be jolly, lords.
These quicksands, Lepidus. Keep off them, or you sink.
Well, thou be lord of all the world.
What sayest thou?
Well, thou be lord of the whole world. That's twice.
How should that be?
But entertain it. And though thou think me poor, I am the man will give thee all the world.
Show me which way.
These three world-sharers, these competitors, are in thy vessel. Let me cut the cable, and when we are put off, fall to their throats. All there is thine.
This thou shouldst have done and not have spoke on it. In meat is villainy, and thee it had been good service. Being then unknown, I should have afterwards found it well done, but must condemn it now. Desist and drink!
For this I'll never follow thy palled fortunes more. Who seeks and will not take when once 'tis offered, shall never find it more.
This health for Lepidus.
Bear him, O'Shore. I'll pledge it for him.
Here's to thee, Manus.
In a barbus. Welcome.
They'll tell a cup they
Here's a strong fellow, Manus.
Why?
Appears the third part of the world, man, sees not.
The third part then is drunk. Would it were all that it might go on wheel.
Drink thou, increase the reels.
Come.
This is not yet an Alexandrian feast.
It ripens toward it. Strike the vessels, ho! Here's to Caesar.
Caesar!
I could well forbear it. It's monstrous labor when I wash my brain and it grows fouler.
Be a child of the time.
Possess it, I'll make answer. I'd rather fast from all 4 days than drink so much in one.
Now, my brave emperor, shall we dance the Egyptian bacchanals and celebrate our drink?
That's hard, good soldier.
Come, let's all take hands.
What would you more? Pompey, good night. Good brother, let me request you off. Our graver business frowns at this levity. Strong Enobarb is weaker than the wine, and my own tongue splits what it speaks. The wild disguise is antic to Saul, but needs more words. Good night. Antony, your hand.
I'll try you on the shore.
And shall, sir. Give us your hand.
Oh, Antony, you have my father's house, but what, we are friends. Down into the boot.
Take heed, you fall not.
Manus, I'll not on shore.
No, to my cabin. These drums, these trumpets, flutes, what? Let Neptune hear we bid a loud farewell to these brave fellows. Sound out and be hanged. Sound out.
Woo, says I. There's my cap.
Oh, come, brother.
What, is the brothers parted?
They have dispatched with Pompey. He is gone. The other three are sealing. Octavia weeps to part from Rome. Caesar is sad. And Lepidus, since Pompey's feast, as Manus says, is troubled with a green sickness.
Ah, 'tis a noble Lepidus.
A very fine one. Oh, how he loves Caesar.
Nay, but how dearly he adores Mark Antony.
Caesar? Why, he's the Jupiter of men.
What's Antony, the god of Jupiter?
Speak you of Caesar? How, the nonpareil?
Oh, Antony, oh, thou Arabian bird.
Wouldst thou praise Caesar, say Caesar, go no further.
Indeed, he plies them both with excellent praises.
Yet he loves Caesar best, yet he loves Antony. Whew! Hearts, tongues, figures, scribes, bards, poets, cannot think, speak, cast, write, sing, number. Whoo! Here's love to Antony. But as for Caesar, kneel down and wonder.
Both he loves.
They are his shards and he their beetle. So this is to horse. Farewell, noble Agrippa.
Good fortune, worthy soldier, and farewell.
No farther, sir.
You take from me a great part of myself. Use me well in it. Sister, prove such a wife as my thoughts make thee. Most noble Antony, let not the piece of virtue that is set betwixt us as a cement of our love to keep it builded be the ram to batter the fortress of it.
Make me not offended in your distrust.
I have said.
You shall not find, though you be therein curious, the least cause for what you seem to fear. So the gods keep you.
Farewell, dearest sister. Fare thee well. The elements be kind to thee and make thy spirits all of comfort. Fare thee well.
My noble brother.
The April's in her eyes. It is love's spring, and these the showers to bring it on. Be cheerful.
Good sir, look well to my husband's house. And...
what, Octavia?
I'll tell you in your ear.
Her tongue will not obey her heart, nor can her heart inform her tongue.
Will Caesar weep?
He has a cloud in his face.
No, sweet Octavia. You shall hear from me still. The time shall not outgo my thinking on you.
Come, sir, come. Look, here I have you. Thus I let you go and give you to the gods.
Adieu. Be happy.
Let all the number of the stars give light to thy fair way.
Farewell. Farewell.
Farewell.
Please,
sir. Half afraid to come.
Go to, come hither, sir.
Didst thou behold Octavia?
Aye, dread queen.
Where?
Madam, in Rome. I looked her in the face and saw her led between her brother and Mark Antony.
She is tall as me.
She is not, madam.
Didst hear her speak? Is she shrill-tongued or low?
Madam, I heard her speak. She is low-voiced.
That's not so good. We cannot like her long.
Like her? Oh, Isis, 'tis impossible.
I think so, Carmion, dull of tongue and dwarfish. What majesty is in her gait? Remember if e'er thou look'st on majesty.
She creeps. Her motion and her station are as one. She shows a body rather than the life, a statue than a breather.
Is it certain?
For I have no observance.
Three in Egypt cannot make better note.
Very knowing, I do perceived. There's nothing in her yet. The fellow has good judgment.
Excellent.
Guess at her years, I prithee.
Madam, she was a widow.
A widow? Come in hard.
And I do think she's 30.
Oh, bearest thou in mind her face? Is long or round?
Round, even to faultiness.
For the most part, they are foolish that are so. Her hair, what color?
Brown, madam, and her forehead as low as she would wish it.
There's gold for thee. Thou must not take my former sharpness ill. I will employ thee back again. I find thee most fit for business. Go make thee ready. Our letters are prepared.
A proper man.
Oh, indeed he is so. I repent me much that I so harried him. Why, methinks by him this creature's no such thing.
Nothing, madam.
The man hath seen some majesty and should know.
Hath he seen majesty? Isis else defend, and serving you so long.
I have one thing yet to ask of him, good Carmion, but 'tis no matter. Thou shalt bring him to me, where I will write. All may be well enough.
I warrant you, madam.
Nay, Octavia, not only that were excusable. But he hath waged new wars against Pompey, made his will and read it in the public ear, spoke scantly of me. And when perforce he could not but pay me terms of honor, coldly and sickly he vented them.
My good lord, believe not all. Or if you must believe, stomach not all. More unhappy lady, if this division chance ne'er stood between, praying for both parts. The good gods will mock me presently, when I shall pray, oh, bless my lord and husband, and undo that prayer by crying out as loud, oh, bless my brother. Husband, win, brother, praise and destroys the prayer. No midway twixt these extremes at all.
Gentle Octavia, if I lose mine honor, I lose myself. Better I wear not yours than yours so branchless. But as you requested, yourself shall go between us.
Thanks to my lord. The Jove of power makes me most weak. Your reconciler. Wars twixt you two would be as if the world should cleave, and that slain men should solder up the rift.
When it appears to you where this begins, turn your displeasure that way. For our faults can never be so equal that your love can equally move with them. Provide your going. Choose your own company and command what cost your heart has mine to.
How now, friend Eris?
There's strange news come, sir.
What men?
Caesar and Lepidus have made wars against Pompey.
Oh, that is old. What is the success?
Caesar, having made use of him in the wars against Pompey, presently denied him rivality and would not let him take part in the glory of the action. Not resting here, accuses him of letters he had formerly wrote to Pompey upon his own appeal. Seizes him. So the poor third is up till death enlarge his confine.
Then, world, thou hast a pair of chops, no more. And throw between them all the food thou canst. They'll grind the one the other. Where's Antony?
He's walking in the garden, thus, and spurns the rush that lies before him, cries out, fool Lepidus, and threats the throat of that his officer that murdered Pompey.
Our great navy's rigged.
For Italy and Caesar.
Twill be not, but let it be. Bring me to Antony.
Come, sir.
Lieutenant Romeo hath done all this and more in Alexandria. Here's the manner of it. In the marketplace on a tribunal silver, Cleopatra and himself on chairs of gold were publicly enthroned. At the feet sat Caesarion, whom they called my father's son, and all the unlawful issue that the lust since then hath made between them. Unto her he gave the establishment of Egypt, and made her of Lower Syria, Cyprus, and Lydia, absolute queen.
This in the public eye?
To the common showplace where they exercise, He there proclaimed his sons the kings of kings.
Let Rome be thus informed.
The people know it and have now received his accusation.
Who does he accuse?
Caesar. And having in Sicily Sextus Pompeius spoiled, we had not rated him his part of the isle. Then he frets that Lepidus of the Triumvirate should be deposed, and being, we detain all his revenue.
Sir, this should be answered.
It is done already, and the messenger gone. I have told him Lepidus was grown too cruel, that he his high authority abused, and did deserve his change. For what I have conquered, I grant him part. But in his Armenia and his conquered kingdoms, I demand the like.
He'll never yield to that.
It must not then be yielded to in this.
Hail Caesar and my lord. Hail most dear Caesar.
That ever I should call thee castaway.
You have not done so, nor have you called.
Why have you stolen upon us thus? You come not like Caesar's sister. The wife of Antony should have an army for an usher, and the neighs of horses to tell of her approach, long as she did appear. But you are come a market maid to Rome.
Good my lord. To come thus was I not constrained, but did it of my free will. My lord Mark Antony, hearing that you prepared for war, acquainted my grieved ear withal, whereon I begged his pardon for return.
Which soon he granted, being the obstruct between his lust and him.
Do not say so, my lord.
I have eyes upon him, and his affairs come to me on the wind. Where is he now?
My lord, in Athens.
No, my most wronged sister. Cleopatra hath knotted him to her. He hath given his empire up to a whore, who now are levying the kings of the earth for war.
Why, me, most wretched, to have my heart parted betwixt two friends that do afflict each other.
Welcome hither, nothing so dear to me. You are abused beyond the mark of thought. And the gods, to do you justice, do make them ministers of us and those that love you. Best of comfort, and ever welcome to us.
Welcome, lady.
Welcome, dear madam. Each heart in Rome does love and pity you. Only the adulterous Antony, most large in his abominations, turns you off and gives his potent regiment to a trull that noises it against us.
Is it so, sir?
Most certain. Sister, welcome. I pray you, be ever known to patience, my dearest sister.
I will be even with thee, doubt it not.
But why? Why? Why?
Thou hast prospered my being in these wars and sayst it is not fit.
Well, is it? Is it?
If not denounced against us, why should we not be there in person?
Well, I could reply. If we should serve with horse and mares together, the horse were merely lost. The mare would bear the soldier and his horse.
What is to say?
Your presence needs must puzzle Antony. Take from his brain, take from his heart, from his time, what should not then be spared. He's already traduced for levity. It's said in Rome that Photonus, a eunuch, and your maids manage this war.
Sink Rome and their tongues rot. I will not stay behind.
Nay, I have done. Here comes the emperor.
It's not strange, Canidius, that from Tarentum and Brundusium he could so quickly cut the Ionian Sea and take in Taurin. You've heard on it, sweet?
Celerity is never more admired than by the negligent.
A good rebuke, which might have well become the best of men to taunt its slackness. Canidius, we will fight with him by sea.
By sea? What else?
Why will my lord do so?
For that he dares us to it.
Well, so if my lord dared him to single fight.
Aye, and to wage this battle at Pharsalia, where Caesar fought with Pompey. But these offers would serve not for his vantage. He shakes off, and so should you.
Your ships are not well manned. In Caesar's fleet are those that often have against Pompey fought. Their ships are yare, yours heavy. No disgrace shall fall you for refusing him at sea.
By sea, by sea.
Most worthy sir. You therein throw away the absolute soldiership you have by land. Distract your army, which doth most consist of war-marked footmen. Leave unexecuted your own renown and knowledge. Quite forego the way that promises assurance. Give up yourself merely to chance and hazard from firm security.
I'll fight with him by sea.
I have 60 sails, Caesar none better.
Our overplus of shipping will be burned. And with the rest, full men from the head of Actium beat the approaching Caesar. But if we fail, we then can do it by land. Thy business.
The news is true, my lord. He is decried. Caesar has taken Taurin.
Can he be there in person? It is impossible. Strange that his power should be. Canidius, our 19 legions that should hold by land, and our 12,000 horse.
Wheel to our ship. Away, my Thetis.
How now, worthy soldier?
Oh, noble emperor, do not fight by sea. Trust not to rotten planks. Do you misdoubt this sword and these my wounds?
Let the Egyptians and the Venetians go a-ducking. We have used this to conquer standing on the earth and fighting foot to foot.
Well, so wait.
But Hercules, I think I am in the right.
Soldier thou art, but his whole action grows not in the power on it. So our leader's led and we are women's men.
You keep by land the legions and the horse hold, do you not?
We keep all by land. This speed of Caesar's carries beyond belief.
While he was yet in Rome, his power went out from such distractions as beguiled all spies.
Who's his lieutenant? Here you.
They say one Maecenas.
Well, I know the man.
The emperor calls Cornelius.
Maecenas!
My lord?
Strike not by land, keep hold. Provoke not battle till we have done at sea. Do not exceed the prescript of the scroll. Our fortune lies upon this jump.
Send me our squadrons on yon side of the hill, and I am Caesar's battle, from which point we may the number of his ships behold, and so proceed accordingly.
Not! Not! Oh, not! I can behold no longer. The Antony had the Egyptian admiral and all their 60 fly and turn the rudder. To see it, mine eyes are blasted.
Gods and goddesses! All the whole synod of them!
What's thy passion?
The greater candle of the world is lost with very ignorance. We've kissed away kingdoms and provinces.
How appears the fight?
On our side, like the token pestilence where death is sure. Yon rabaudred nag of Egypt, whom leprosy are take. In the midst of the fight, when vantage like a pair of twins appeared, both as the same, or rather ours the elder, the breeze upon her like a cow in June, hoist sails and fly.
By help, my eyes get sickened at the sight that could not endure a further view.
She wants being loof, the noble ruin of her magic Antony, claps on his sea wing and like a doting mallard flies after her. I never saw an action of such shame. Experience, manhood, honor, and every fort it violates, so it's alack-a-lack.
Our fortune of the sea is out of breath and sinks most lamentably. Had our general been what he knew himself, it had gone well. Oh, he has given example for our flight most grossly by his own.
Aye, are you thereabouts? Well, then good night indeed.
To Caesar will I render my legions and my horse. Six kings already show me the way of yielding.
I'll still follow the wounded chance of Antony. Though my reason sits in the wind against me.
Ha! The land bids me tread no more upon it. It is a shame to bear me. Friends, come hither. I am so elated in the world that I have lost my way forever. I have a ship laden with gold in the harbor. Take that, divide it, fly, and make your peace with Caesar.
No, not we.
I have fled myself and have instructed cowards the way to run and show their shoulders.
Friends, be gone. I have myself resolved upon a course which has no need of you. My treasure's in the harbor, take it. Oh, I have followed that I blush to look upon. My very hairs do mutiny, for the white reprove the brown for rashness, and they them for fear and doting. Pray look not sad, nor make replies of loathness. Take the hint which my despair proclaims. Let that be left which leaves itself. To the seaside straightway. Leave me, I pray, a little. Pray you now. Nay, do so. For I have lost command. And therefore I pray you. I'll see you by and by.
Nay, gentle madam, to him comfort you.
Do, most dear queen.
Do, why what else?
Let me sit down, no Juno.
No, 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 no.
Here, sir.
Oh, fie.
Sir.
Yes, my lord, yes. He at Philippi kept his sword in like a dancer, while I struck the lean and wrinkled Cassius. 'Twas I that the mad Brutus ended. He alone dealt on lieutenantry, and no practice had in the brave squares of war. Yet now,
No matter.
Stand by.
Sir, the queen.
Go to him, madam. Speak to him. He's unqualified with very shame.
Very well, sustain me then. Most noble sir, arise. The queen approaches. Our heads declined, and death will seize her, but your comfort make the rescue.
I have offended reputation by most unnoble swerving.
Sir, the queen.
Oh, whither hast thou led me, Egypt?
Lord, forgive my fearful sails. I little thought you would have followed.
Egypt, thou knewst too well my heart was to thy rudder tied by the strings, and thou shouldst tow me after.
Oh, my pardon.
Now I must to the young man send humble treaties. Dodge and falter in the shifts of lowness, with half the bulk of the world played as I pleased, making and marring fortunes. You didn't know how much you were my conqueror, and that my sword made weak by my affection would obey it on all cause.
Pardon, pardon.
Fall not a tear, I see. One of them rates all that is won and lost. Give me a kiss. Even this repays me. We sent our schoolmaster. Is he come back? Fortune knows we scorn her most when most she offers blows.
Fear that come from Antony. Know you him?
'Tis his schoolmaster. An argument that he has plucked when hither he sends so poor opinion of his wing, which had superfluous kings for messengers not many moons gone by.
Approach and speak.
Such as I am, I come from Antony. Lord of his fortunes, he salutes thee and requires to live in Egypt. Which, not granted, he lessens his requests, and to thee sues to let him breathe between the heavens and earth, a private man in Athens. This for him. Next, Cleopatra does confess thy greatness, submits her to thy might, and of thee craves the circle of the Ptolemies for her heirs, now hazarded to thy grace.
For Antony, I have no ears to his request. The queen of audience nor desire shall fail, so she from Egypt drive her all disgraced friend, or take his life there. This, if she perform, she shall not sue unheard. So do them both.
Fortune pursue thee.
Bring him through the bands.
To try thy eloquence, now
'tis time. Dispatch. From Antony, win Cleopatra. Promise, and in our name, what she requires. Add more from thine invention, offers. Try thy cunning, Tereus. Make thine own edict for thy pains, and we will answer as a law.
Caesar,
I go.
What shall we do, Greenabas?
Die.
Is Antony or we in fault for this?
Antony only. It would make his will lord of his reason. What though you fled from that great face of war, and several rangers frighted each other? Why should he follow? The itch of his affection should not then have nicked his captainship.
Pretty peace.
Is that his answer?
Aye, my lord.
The queen shall then have courtesy, so she will yield us up.
He says so.
Let her know it. To the boy Caesar, send this grizzled head, and he will fill thy wishes to the brim with principalities.
That head, my lord.
To him again. Tell him he wears the rose of youth upon him, from which the world should note something particular. I dare him, therefore, to lay his gay comparisons apart and answer me declined. Sword against sword, ourselves alone. I'll write it, follow me.
Yes. Like enough, the high-battled Caesar will unstate his happiness to be staged to the show against a sworder. I see men's judgments are a parcel of their fortunes, and outward things do draw the inward quality after them to suffer all alike. That he should dream, knowing all measures, the full Caesar will answer his emptiness. Caesar, thou hast subdued his judgment too.
A messenger from Caesar.
What? No more ceremony? See my women against the blown rose. May they stop their nose that kneeled unto the buds.
Admit him, sir.
Mine honesty and I begin to square. The loyalty well held to fools does make our faith mere folly. Yet he that can endure to follow with allegiance a fallen lord does conquer him that did his master conquer, and earns a place of the story.
Caesar's will.
Hear it apart.
None but friends say boldly.
So? Thus then thou most renowned. Caesar entreats not to consider in what case thou standst more than he is Caesar.
Go on, right royal.
He knows that you embrace not Antony as you did love, but as you feared him.
Oh?
The scars upon your honor, therefore, he pities as constrained blemishes and not as deserved.
He is a god and knows what is most right. Mine honor was not yielded, but conquered merely.
To be sure of that, I will ask Antony. Oh, sir, sir, thou art so leaky, we must leave thee to thy sinking, for thy dearest quit thee.
Shall I say to Caesar what you require of him? It would much please him that of his fortunes you should make a staff to lean upon. But it would warm his spirit to hear from me you had left Antony and put yourself under his shroud, the universal landlord.
What is thy name?
My name is Tyrius.
Most kind messenger, say to great Caesar this. In deputation I kiss his conquering hand. Tell him I am prompt to lay my crown at his feet and there to kneel. Tell him from his all-obeying breath I hear the doom of Egypt.
'Tis your noblest cause. Give me grace to lay my duty on your hand.
You're Caesar's father oft, when he hath mused of taking kingdoms in, bestowed his lips on that unworthy place as it rained kisses.
Favors, by Jove, that thunders! What art thou, fellow?
One that but performs the bidding of the fullest man and worthiest to have command obeyed.
You will be whipped. Approach there! Are you kite? Of gods and devils, authority melts from me. Of late, when I cried, ho, like boys and were must, kings would start forth and cry your will. Have you no ears? I am Antony yet. Take hence this jack and whip him.
It's better playing with a lion's whelp than with an old one dying.
Moon and stars, whip him. Were it 20 of the greatest tributaries that do acknowledge Caesar, should I find them so saucy with the hand of she here? What's her name since she was Cleopatra? Whip him till like a boy you see him cringe his face and whine aloud for mercy. Take him hence!
Mark Antony!
Tug him away! Be whip, bring him again!
This jack of Caesar shall bear us an errand for him.
You were half blasted ere I knew you. Ha! Have I my pillow left unpressed in Rome? For born the getting of a lawful race and by a gem of women to be abused by one that looks on feeders.
Oh, Lord.
You have been a boggler ever. But when we in our viciousness grow hard, oh misery on it. The wise gods seal our eyes. In our own filth drop our clear judgments, make us adore our errors, laugh at us, as we strut to our confusion.
You must come to this.
I found you as a morsel cold upon dead Caesar's trencher. Nay, you are a fragment of Gnaeus Pompey's. Besides, what hotter hours unregistered in vulgar fame you have luxuriously picked out. For I am sure, though you can guess what temperance should be, you know not what it is.
Wherefore is this?
To let a fellow that would take rewards and say, God quit you, be familiar with my playfellow, your hand, that kingly seal and plighter of high hearts. Is he whipped?
Soundly, my lord.
Cried he and begged he pardon.
He did ask favor.
If that thy father live, let him repent thou wast not made his daughter. And be thou sorry to follow Caesar in his triumph, since thou hast been whipped for following him. Henceforth a white hand of a lady fever thee. Shake but to look upon it. Get thee back to Caesar, tell him thy entertainment. And look you, say he makes me angry with him. For he seems proud and disdainful, laughing on what I am, not what he knew I was. He makes me angry. Hence with thy strength begun!
Have you done yet?
Alack, our tarrying moon is now eclipsed, and it portends alone the fall of Antony.
I must stay his time.
To flatter Caesar, would you mingle eyes with one that ties his points?
Not know me yet.
Cold-hearted toward me?
Dear, if I be so, from my cold heart let heaven engender hail and poison it in the source. Let the first stone drop in my neck as it determines so dissolve my life. The next Caesarian smite, till by degrees the memory of my womb, together with my brave Egyptians all, by the discanding of this pelleted storm like graveless, till the flies and gnats of Nile have buried them for prey.
I am satisfied. Our force by land hath nobly held. Our severed navy too hath knit again, a fleet threatening most sea-like. Where hast thou been, my heart? Dost thou hear, lady? If from the field I shall return once more to kiss these lips, I will appear in blood. I and my sword will earn our chronicle. There's hope in it yet.
Alas, my brave lord!
I will be treble-sinewed, hearted, breathed, and fight maliciously. For when mine hours were nice and lucky, men did ransom lives of me for jests. But now I'll set my teeth and send to darkness all that stopped me. Come, let's have one other gaudy night. Call to me all our said captains, fill our bowls. Once more let's mock the midnight bell.
Oh, it is my birthday. I thought to have held it poor, but since my lord is Antony again, I will be Cleopatra.
There's hope in it yet.
That's my brave lord. Call all his noble captains to my lord.
Do so, we'll speak to them. And tonight I'll force the wine peep through their scars. Come on, my queen. There's sap in it yet. The next time I do fight, I'll make death love me, for I will contend even with his pestilent scythe.
No, you'll outstare the lightning. To be furious is to be frighted out of fear. And in that mood, the dove will peck the estridge. And I see still, a diminution in our captain's brain restores his heart. When valor preys on reason, it eats the sword it fights with. I will seek some way to leave him.
He calls me boy, and chides as he had power to beat me out of Egypt. My messenger he hath whipped with rods, dares me to personal combat, Caesar to Antony. Let the old ruffian know I've many other ways to die. Meanwhile, laugh at his challenge. Tomorrow, the last of many battles we mean to fight. Within our files, there are of those that served Mark Antony but late. Enough to fetch him in. See it done. And feast the army. We have store to do it. They have earned the waste. Poor Antony.
He will not fight with me, Domitius.
No.
Why should he not?
He thinks being 20 times a better fortune, he's 20 men to one.
Tomorrow, soldier, by sea and land I'll fight. Or I will live or bathe my dying honor, and the blood shall make it live again. Wilt thou fight, Will?
I'll strike and cry take all.
Well said. Come on, call to me all my household servants. Let's tonight be bounteous in our meal. Give me thy hand. Thou hast been rightly honest, and so hast thou, and thou. You have served me well, and kings have been your fellows.
What means this?
It's one of those odd tricks which sorrow shoots out of the mind.
And thou art honest, too. I wish that I might do you service so good as you have done.
But God, see, my good lord.
Well, my good fellows, wait on me tonight. Scant not my cups, and make as much of me as when mine empire was your fellow, too, and suffered my command.
What does he mean?
Make his followers weep?
Tend me tonight. Maybe it is the period of your duty. Haply you shall not see me more. Or if a mangled shadow, perchance tomorrow you'll serve another master. I look on you as one that takes his leave. I turn you not away, but like a master married to your good service, stay till death. Tend me tonight 2 hours. I ask no more, and the gods yield you for it.
What mean you, sir, to give them this discomfort? Look, they weep.
And I, an ass, an onion-eyed,
for saying transform us not to women.
Now the witch take me if I meant it thus. Grace grow where those drops fell. My hearty friend, you take me to dolorous a sense. I hope well of tomorrow, and will lead you where rather I'll expect victorious life than death and honor. Let's to supper, come, and drown consideration.
Brother, good night. Tomorrow is the day.
It'll determine one way. Fare you well. I heard you have nothing strange about the streets.
Nothing? What news?
Belike 'tis but a rumor. Good night to you.
Well, sir, good night. Soldier, have careful watch.
Good night.
Peace! What noise?
List. List!
Hark.
Music. In the air.
Under the earth.
It signs well, does it not?
No.
Peace, I say. What should this mean?
'Tis the god Hercules whom Antony loved. Now leaves him.
Walk, let's see if other watchmen do hear what we do.
Follow the noise so far as we have quarter. Let's see how it will give off.
Content. 'Tis strange.
Arrows! Mine armor arrows!
Sleep a little.
No, my child. Arrows, come! Mine armor arrows! Come, my fellow, put mine iron on. Fortune be not ours today, it is because we brave her.
Nay, I'll help too. What's this for?
Ah, let be, let be. Thou art the armor of my heart. Force, force, this.
Soothla, I'll help. Thus it must be.
Well, we shall thrive now. Seest thou, my good fellow? Go put on thy defenses.
Briefly, sir.
Is not this buckled well?
Rarely. He that unbuckles this, till we do please to doff for our repose, shall bear a storm. Thou fumblest, Eros. My queen's a squire more tight at this than thou. Dispatch. Oh, love, that thou couldst see me in my wars today and use the royal occupation. Thou should see a workman in it. Come, give me that. This way. Well said. Fare thee well, dame. Whate'er becomes of me, this is a soldier's kiss. Rebukable and worthy, shameful check it were, to stand on more mechanic compliment. Adieu.
The gods make this a happy day to Antony.
Would thou and those thy scars at once prevail to make me fight at land?
Hadst thou done so, the kings that have revolted and the soldiers that has this morning left thee would still have followed thy heel.
Who's gone this morning?
Who? One ever near thee. Call for Enobarbus. He shall not hear thee, or from Caesar's camp say, I am none of thine.
What sayest thou?
Sir, he is with Caesar.
Sir, his chest and treasure he has not with him?
Is he gone?
Most certain.
Go, Eros. Send his treasure after. Do it. Detain no jot, I charge thee. Write to him. I will subscribe. Gentle adieus and greetings. Say I hope he never find more cause to change a master. Oh, my fortunes have corrupted honest men. Dispatch. Enobarbus.
Go forth, Agrippa, and begin the fight. Our will is Antony be took alive. Make it so now.
Caesar, I shall.
The time of universal peace is near. Prove this a prosperous day. The three-nooked world shall bear the olive freely.
Antony has come into the field.
Go charge, Agrippa. Plant those that have revolted in the van, that Antony may seem to spend his fury upon himself.
Alexis did revolt and went to jury on affairs of Antony. There did persuade great Herod to incline himself to Caesar and leave his master Antony. For this pain, Caesar hath hanged him. Canidius and the rest that fell away have entertainment, but no honorable trust. I have done ill, which I do accuse myself so sorely that I will joy no more.
Enobarbus, Antony hath after thee sent all thy treasure with his bounty over plus. The messenger came on my guard, and at thy tent is now unloading of his mules.
I give it you.
Mock not, Enobarbus, I tell thee true. Thy emperor continues still a Jove.
Oh, I am alone the villain of the earth, and feel I am so most. Oh, Antony, thou mine of bounty, how wouldst thou have paid my better service when my turpitude thou dost so crown with gold? This blows my heart. If swift thought break it not, a swifter mean shall outstrike thought, but thought will do it, I feel. I fight against thee. No. I will go seek some ditch wherein to die, for Faust best fits my latter part of life.
Retire. We have engaged ourselves too far. Caesar himself has work, and our oppression exceeds what we expected.
Oh, my brave emperor, this is what indeed. Had we done so at first, we had driven them home with clouts about their heads.
Stop, bleats a pace.
I have a wound here that was like a T, but now 'tis made an H.
They do retire.
We'll beat them into bench holes. I have yet room for six scotches more.
Sir, they are beaten, and our advantage serves for a fair victory.
Let us score the backs and snatch them up as we take hares behind. 'Tis sport to maul a runner.
I will reward thee once for thy sprightly comfort and tenfold for thy good valor. Come thee on.
I'll halt after.
We'll beat him to his cap. Run one before let the queen know of our jests. Tomorrow, before the sun shall see us, we'll spill the blood that is today escaped. I thank you all. Enter the city, clip your wives, your friends, tell them your feats, whilst they with joyful tears wash the congealment from your wounds and kiss your honor gashes whole. Give me thy hand. To this great fairy I'll commend thine acts. Make her thanks bless thee. Oh, the day of the world! Chain mine armed neck! Leap thou a tyrant old through proof of earnest to my heart, and there right on the pence triumphing.
Lord of lords, a infinite virtue, comest thou smiling from the world's great snare uncaught?
My nightingale, we beat them to their beds. What, girl? Though gray do something mingle with our younger brown, yet if we a brain that nourishes our nerves and can get gold for goal of youth.
Behold this man. Commend unto his lips thy favoring hand. Kiss it, my warrior. He hath fought today as if a god innate of mankind had destroyed in such a shape.
I'll give thee, friend, an armor all of gold. It was a king.
He hath deserved it were it carbuncled like holy Phoebus' car. Give me thy hand. Through Alexandria make a jolly march. Bear our hack targets like the men that owe them. Had our great palace the capacity to camp this host, we all would sup together and drink carouses to the next day's fate, which promises royal peril. Trumpeters, with brazen din blast you the city's ear. Make mingle with our rattling tambourines that heaven and earth may strike their sons together, applauding our approach.
If we be not relieved within the hour, we must return to the court of guard. Well, the night is shiny. They say we shall embattle by the second hour of morn.
This last day was a shrewd one to us.
Oh, bear me witness, knight.
What man is this?
Stand close and list him.
Be witness to me, O thou blessed moon. When men revolted, shall the von record bear a hateful memory. Poor Enobarbus did before thy face repent.
Enobarbus, cease. Hark further.
O sovereign mistress of true melancholy, the poisonous damp of night did sponge upon me, that life, the very revel to my will, may hang no longer on me. Throw my heart against the flint and hardness of my fault, which being dried with grief will break to powder and finish all foul thoughts. Oh, Antony, nobler than my revolt is infamous. Forgive me in thine own particular. But let the world rank me and register a master lever and a fugitive. Oh, Antony. Oh, Antony.
Let's speak to him.
Let's hear him. For the things he speaks may concern Caesar.
Hear you, sir? The hand of death hath wrought him. Hark. The drums demurely wake the sleepers. Let us bear him to the court of God. He is of note. Our hour is fully out. Come on, men. We may recover yet.
Their preparation is today by sea. We please them not by land.
Or both, my lord.
Would they fight at the fire of the air, we'd fight there too. But thus it is. Our foot upon the hills adjoining to the city shall stay for us. Order for sea is given. They have put forth the haven. Go we hence, where their appointment we may best discover and look on their endeavor. Yet they are not joined. Where yon pine doth stand, I shall discover all. I'll bring thee word straight out, 'tis like to go.
Swallows have built in Cleopatra's sails their nests. The augurers say they know not, they cannot tell, look grimly and dare not speak their knowledge. Antony is valiant and dejected, and by starts his fretted fortunes give him hope and fear of what he has and has not.
All is lost. This foul Egyptian hath betrayed me. My fleet have yielded to the foe, and yonder they cast their caps up and carouse together like friends long lost. Triple Dandor!
'Tis thou hast sold me to this novice, and my heart makes only wars on thee.
Bid them all fly, for when I am revenged upon my charm, I have done all. Bid them all fly! Begone! O son, thy uprise shall I see no more. Fortune and Antony part here. Even here do we shake hands. Oh, come to this. The hearts that spanieled me at heels, to whom I gave their wishes, do discandy, melt their sweets on blossoming Caesar. And this pine is bark that overtopped them all. Oh, this false soul of Egypt, this grave charm whose eye becked forth my wars and called them home, whose bosom was my crown at my chief end, like a right gypsy at the first and loose beguiled me to the very heart of loss. What Eros? Eros! Ah, the spell of one!
Is my lord enraged against his love?
Vanish, or I shall give thee thy deserving and blemish Caesar's triumph. Let him take thee and hoist thee up to the shouting plebeians. Follow his chariot like the greatest spot of all thy sex. Most monster-like be shown for poorest diminutives or doits. And let patient Octavia plow thy visage up with her prepared nails.
'Tis well thou art gone, if it be well to live. But better 'twere thou fell'st into my fury by one death preventing many. Heroes, ho! The shirt of Nessus is upon me. Teach me, Alcides, thou mine ancestor, thy rage. Subdue my worthier self. The witch shall die. To the young Roman boy she hath sold me, and I fall into this plot. She dies for it. Eros! Eros!
Help me, my women. Hoy is more mad than Telamon for his shield.
To the monument. There, lock yourself, and send him word you are dead. The soul and body rive not more in parting than greatness going on.
To the monument. Go to him, Marion. Tell him I have slain myself. Say that the last I spoke was Antony, and word it pretty piteously. Hence, Marion, and bring me how he takes my death. To the monument.
Eros, thou yet beholdst me.
My noble lord.
Sometimes we see a cloud that's dragonish. A vapor sometimes like a bear or lion. Towered citadel, pendant rock, forked mountain, blue promontory with trees upon it that nod unto the world and mock our eyes with air. Thou hast seen these signs. They are Black Vesper's pageant.
Aye, my lord.
That which is now a horse, even with a thought the rack dislimns and makes it indistinct, as water is in water.
It does, my lord.
My good knave, Eros, now thy captain is even such a body. Here I am, Antony, yet cannot hold this visible shape, my knave. I made these wars for Egypt. And the queen, whose heart I thought I had, for she had mine, which whilst it was mine had annexed unto it a million more, now lost. She, Eros, has packed cards with Caesar, and false played my glory unto an enemy's triumph. Nay, weep not, gentle Eros. There is left us ourselves to end ourselves. Oh, thy vile lady, she hath robbed me of my sword.
No, Antony. Mistress loved thee, and her fortunes mingled with thine entirely.
Hence, saucy eunuch beast! She hath betrayed me and shall die the death.
Death of one person can be paid but once. That she is discharged. What thou wouldst do is done under thy hand. The last she spake was Antony, most noble Antony. And in the midst of tearing groan did break the name of Antony. It was divided between our heart and lips. She rendered life, thy name so buried in her.
Dead then.
Dead.
Unarm me, Eros. Long day's task is done, and we must sleep. But thou departs hence safe, dost pay thy labor richly. Go! Off! Pluck off! Sevenfold shield of Ajax cannot keep the battery from my heart, or cleave my sides. Heart, once be stronger than thy continent. Crack thy frail case. Pace, Eros, pace. No more a soldier. Bruised pieces go. You have been nobly born. From you. I will o'ertake thee, Cleopatra, and weep for my pardon. So it must be, for now all length is torture. Since the torch is out, lie down and stray no farther. Now all labor mars what it does. A very force entangles itself with strength. Seal then, and all is done. Eros,
I come, my queen. Eros, stay for me. Where souls do couch on flowers, we'll hand in hand. And with our sprightly port make the ghosts gaze. Dido and Herenia shall want troops, and all the haunt be ours. But Eros, Eros!
What would, my lord?
Since Cleopatra died, I have lived in such dishonor that the gods detest my baseness. I, that with my sword courted the world, and o'er green Neptune's back with ships made cities, condemn myself to lack the courage of a woman. Thou hast sworn, Eros, that when the exigent should come, which now is come indeed, that on my command thou then wouldst kill me. Do it, the time is come. Thou strikest not me, 'tis Caesar thou defeats. Put color in thy cheek.
The gods withhold me.
Eros, wouldst thou be windowed in great Rome, and see thy master thus with pleached arms bending down his corrigible neck, his face subdued to penetrative shame, whilst the wheel seat of fortunate Caesar drawn before him branded his baseness that ensued?
I would not see it.
Come then. For with a wound, I must be cured.
Oh, sir, pardon me.
Eros, when I did make thee free, swore'st thou nothing to do this when I bade thee? Do it, for thy preceding services are all with accidents unpurposed. Draw and come.
Turn from me then that noble countenance wherein the worship of the whole world lies.
Blow thee.
My sword is drawn.
Then let it do at once the thing where thou hast drawn it.
Farewell, Richie. Shall I strike now?
No, Eros.
Why, there, thus do I escape the sorrow of these days.
Thrice nobler than myself. Thou teachest me, O valiant Eros, what I should and thou couldst not. My queen and Eros have by their brave instruction got upon me a nobleness in record. But I will be a bridegroom in my death, and run into it as to a lover's bed. Come then. And Eros, thy master dies thy scholar.
To do thus, he learned of thee. Not dead. Not dead. The guard who dispatched me.
I have done my work ill, friends.
Oh, make an end of what I have begun.
The star is fallen,
and time is at its period.
Art thou there, Mardian? Draw thy sword and give me sufficing strokes for death.
Most absolute lord, my mistress Cleopatra sent me to thee.
When did she send thee?
Now, my lord.
Where is she?
Locked in her monument. She had a prophesying fear of what had come to pass. For when she saw, which never shall be found, you did suspect she had disposed of Caesar, and that your rage would not be purged. She sent you word she was dead, but fearing since how it might work, hath sent me to proclaim the truth. I am come, I dread, too late.
Too late, good Mardian. Call my guard, I prithee.
The Emperor's guard, come, your lord calls.
Bear me where Cleopatra bides. 'Tis the last service that I shall command you.
Woe are we, sir. You may not live to wear all your true followers out.
Most heavy.
Nay, good my fellows. Do not please sharp fate to grace it with your sorrows. Take me up. I have led you off. Carry me now. And have my thanks for all.
Oh, come in, I will never go from here.
Be comforted, dear madam.
No, I will not. All strange and terrible events are welcome, but comforts we despise. Our sighs of sorrow proportion to our cause must be as great as that which makes it. How now, is he dead?
Is death upon him, but not yet dead? His guard have brought him thither.
Sun, burn the great sphere thou movest in, and darkling stand the varying shore of the world. Oh, Antony, Antony, Antony! Help, Carmen, help, Iris, help! Help, friends below, let's draw him hither.
Peace, not Caesar's valor hath o'erthrown Antony, but Antony's hath triumphed on itself.
So it should be, that none but Antony should conquer Antony. Woe to so.
I am dying, Egypt. Dying. Only I here importune death awhile, until of many thousand kisses, poor last, I lay upon thy lips.
I dare not, dear, dear my lord, pardon, I dare not, lest I be taken. Of the imperious show, the full fortune Caesar ever shall be broached with me. If knife, drug, serpent have edge, stinger operation, I am safe. Your wife Octavia, with her modest eyes and still conclusion, shall acquire no honor demurring upon me. But come, come, Antony. Help me, my women. Help, friends below. We must draw thee up.
Oh, quick, or I am gone.
A sport, indeed. How heavy weighs, my lord. Our strength is all gone into heaviness. That makes the weight. Had I great Juno's power, the strong-winged Mercury should draw thee up and set thee by Jove's side. Wishes were ever fools. Yet come, come a little. Come, come and welcome, welcome. Die where thou hast lived, quicken with kissing. Had my lips that power, thus would I wear them out. Heavy sight.
I'm dying, Egypt, dying. Give me some wine, and let me talk a little.
Nay, let me speak, and let me rail so high that the false hearts of fortune breaker wheel provoked by my offense.
Hear me, queen. Of Caesar, seek your honor with your safety.
They do not go together.
Gentle, hear me. None about Caesar trust but Proculeus.
My resolution in my hands I'll trust. None about Caesar.
The miserable change now at my end. Lament no sorrow at. But please your thoughts in feeding them with those my former fortunes, wherein I live the greatest prince of the world, and do now not basely die, nor cowardly put off my helmet to my countrymen. A Roman, by a Roman, valiantly vanquished. Now my spirit is going. I can
no more.
Noblest of men would die. Hast thou no care of me? Shall I abide in this dull world, which in thy absence is no better than a sty? A sea, my women, crown of the earth doth melt. My lord, withered is the garland of the war. The soldier's pole is fallen. Young boys and girls are level now with men. The odds is gone. There is nothing left remarkable beneath the visiting moon.
Oh, quietness, lady.
She is dead too, our sovereign.
Lady,
madam.
Oh, madam, madam, madam.
Royal Egypt, empress.
Peace. Peace, Iris.
No more but in a woman. Commanded by such poor passion as the maid that milks and does the meanest chairs. It were for me to throw my scepter at the injurious gods, to tell them that this world did equal theirs, till they had stolen our jewel. All's but not. What? What? Good cheer? Why, how now, Carmen? My noble girl? Oh, women, women, see, our lamp is spent, it's out. Good says, take heart, we'll bury him. And then what's brave, what's noble, let's do it after the high Roman fashion and make death proud to take us. Come, away. This case of that huge spirit now is cold. Our women come.
We have no friend but resolution and the briefest end.
Go to him, Dolabella, bid him yield. Being so frustrate, tell him he mocks the pauses that he makes.
Caesar, I shall.
Wherefore is that, and what art thou that darest appear thus to us?
I am called their Cetus. Mark Antony I served, who best was worthy, best be served. Whilst he stood up and spoke, he was my master, and I wore my life to spend upon his haters.
What is thou sayest?
I say, O Caesar, Antony is dead.
The breaking of so great a thing should make a greater crack. The round world should have shook lions into civil streets and citizens into their dens. The death of Antony is not a single doom. And the name lay a moiety of the world.
He is dead, O Caesar, by that self-hand which writ his honor in the axe it did, splitted the heart. Here is his sword, I robbed his wound of it. Behold, it's stained with his most noble blood.
Look, you sad friends. The gods rebuke me. But it is tidings to wash the eyes of kings.
And strange it is that nature must compel us to lament our most persistent deeds.
His taints and honors waged equal with him.
A rarer spirit never did steer humanity. But you gods will give us some faults to make us men. Caesar is touched.
When such a spacious mirror is set before him, he needs must see himself.
Oh, Antony, I have followed thee to this. But we do lance diseases in our bodies. I must perforce have shown to thee such a declining day. Oh, look on thine. We could not stall together in the whole world. But yet let me lament with tears as sovereign as the blood of hearts that thou, my brother and competitor in top of all design, my mate in empire, my friend and companion in the front of war, the arm of mine own body, and the heart where mine his thoughts did kindle, that our stars unreconcilable should divide our equalness to this. Hear me, good friend, but I will tell you it's a meter season. The business of this fellow looks out of him. We'll hear him what he says. Whence are you?
A poor Egyptian, yet. The queen, my mistress, of thy intents desires instruction, that she preparedly may frame herself to the way she's forced to.
Bid her have good heart. She soon shall know from some of ours how honorable and how kindly we determine for her. For Caesar cannot live to be ungentle.
So the gods preserve thee.
Come hither, Proculeus. Go and say we purpose her no shame. Give her what comforts the quality of her passion shall require, lest in her greatness by some mortal stroke she do defeat us. For her life in Rome would be eternal in our triumph. Go and bring her with your speediest, bring us what she says. And
Caesar,
how you find
I will.
Go with me to my tent, where you shall see how hardly I was drawn into this war. How calm and gentle I proceeded still in all my writings. Go with me and see what I can show in this.
My desolation does begin to make a better life. It is paltry to be Caesar. Not being fortune, he's but fortune's knave, a minister of her will. And it is great to do that thing which ends all other deeds. Which shackles accidents and bolts up change, which sleeps and never pallets more the dog, the beggar's nurse and Caesar's.
Caesar sends greetings to the Queen of Egypt and bids thee study on what fair demands thou meanst to have him grant thee.
What is thy name?
My name is Proculeus.
Antony did tell me of you, bade me trust you. But I do not greatly care to be deceived, but have no use for trusting. Your master would have a queen, his beggar. You must tell him that majesty to keep decorum must no less beg than a kingdom.
Be of good cheer, you're fallen into a princely hand. Fear nothing. Make your full reference freely to my lord, who is so full of grace that it flows over on all that need. Let me report to him your sweet dependency, and you shall find a conqueror that will pray in aid for kindness where he for grace is kneeled to.
Tell him I am his fortune's vassal and send him the greatness he has got. I hourly learn a doctrine of obedience and would gladly look him in the face.
Madam, I'll so report. Have comfort, for I know your plight is pitied of him that calls.
You see how easily she is surprised? Guard her till Caesar come.
Cleopatra, thou art
quick.
Hold! Worthy lady, hold. Do not yourself this wrong, who are in this relieved, but not betrayed.
What of death, too, that rids our dogs of language?
Cleopatra, do not abuse my master's bounty by the undoing of yourself. Let the world see his nobleness well acted, which your death will never let come forth.
Where art thou, death? Come, 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 and take a queen with many babes and beggars.
Oh, temperance, lady.
If I eat no meat, I'll not drink, sir. If I to talk will once be necessary, I'll not sleep neither. No, sir, that this mortal house I'll ruin, do Caesar what he can. Know that I will not wait pinioned at your master's court, nor once be chastised by the sober eye of dull Octavia. Shall they hoist me up and show me to the shouting varletry of censuring Rome? Rather a ditch in Egypt be gentle grave unto me. Rather on Nilus mud lay me stark naked till the waterflies blow me into abhorring. Rather make my country's high pyramids my gibbets and hang me up in chains.
You do extend these thoughts of horror further than you shall find cause in Caesar.
Proculeus, I'll take her to my guard.
So, Dolabella, it shall content me best. Be gentle to her. To Caesar I will speak what you shall please, if you'll employ me to him.
Say I would die.
Most noble Empress, you have heard of me?
I cannot tell.
Assuredly you know me.
No matter what I have heard or known. You laugh when boys or women tell their dreams. Is not your trick?
Oh, I understand not, madam.
I dreamt there was an Emperor Antony. Such another sleep that I might see but such another man.
If it might please
his
you.
His face was as the heavens, and therein stuck a sun and moon which kept their course and lighted the little o of the earth.
Most sovereign.
His
creature.
Legs bestrid the ocean. His reared arm crested the world. His voice was propertied as all the tuned spheres, and that to friends. But when he meant to quail and shake the orb, he was as rattling thunder. For his bounty there was no winter in it. An autumn 'twas that grew the more by reaping. His delights were dolphin-like. They showed his back above the elements they lived in. In his livery walked crowns and crownets. Realms and islands were as plates dropped from his pocket.
Cleopatra.
Think you there was or might be such a man as this I dreamt of?
Gentle madam, no.
You lie up to the hearing of the gods. Yet if there be or ever were one such, it's past the size of dreaming. Nature wants stuff to vie strange forms with fancy, yet to imagine an Antony, 'twere nature's peace gainst fancy, condemning shadows quite.
Hear me, good madam. Your loss is as yourself great, and you bear it as answering to the weight. Would I might never o'ertake pursued success, but I do feel by the rebound of yours a grief that smites my very heart at root.
I thank you, sir. Know you what Caesar means to do with me?
I am loath to tell you what I would you knew.
May pray you, sir.
Though he be honorable.
He'll lead me then in triumph.
Madam, he will. I know it.
Queen of Egypt.
It is the Emperor, madam.
Arise, you shall not kneel. I pray you rise. Rise, Egypt.
The gods will have it thus. My master and my lord, I must obey.
Take to you no hard thoughts. The record of what injuries you did us, though written in our flesh, we shall remember as things but done by chance.
Soul, sir of the world, I cannot project mine own cause so well to make it clear. But to confess, I have been laden with like frailties which before have often shamed our sex.
Cleopatra, no. We will extenuate rather than enforce. if you apply yourself to our intents, which to you are most gentle, you shall find a benefit in the change. But if you seek to lay on me a cruelty by taking Antony's course, you shall bereave yourself of my good purposes and put your children to that destruction which I'll guard them from, if thereon you rely. I'll take my leave.
And may through all the world 'tis yours. And we, your scutcheons and your signs of conquest, shall hang in what place you please. Hear, my good lord.
You shall advise me in all for Cleopatra.
This is the brief of money, plate and jewels I am possessed of. 'Tis exactly valued, not petty things admitted. Where's Sir Lucas?
Here, madam.
This is my treasurer. Let him speak, my lord, upon his peril, that I have reserved to myself nothing. Speak the truth, Seleucus.
Madam, I had rather seal my lips than to my peril speak that which is not.
What have I kept back?
Enough to purchase what you've made known.
Nay, blush not, Cleopatra. I approve your wisdom in the deed.
See, Caesar, oh, behold how pomp is followed. Mine shall now be yours. And should we shift estates, yours would then be mine. Oh, the ingratitude of this Seleucus, does he make me wild? Oh, slave of no more trust than love that's hired. What? Go'st thou back? Thou shalt go back, I warrant thee. But I'll catch thine eyes though they had wings. Slave, soulless villain, dog, or rarely
good
base.
Good queen, let us entreat
say,
you.
Say, Caesar, that I some lady trifles have reserved. In moment toys, things of such dignity as we greet modern friends withal. And say some nobler tokens I have kept apart for Livia and Octavia, to induce their mediation. Must I be enfolded with one that I have bred? Gods, it smites me beneath the fall I have. Get thee hence, or I shall show the cinders of my spirit through the ashes of my chance. Wert thou a man, thou wouldst have mercy on me.
Forbear, Seleucus. Cleopatra, not what you have reserved, nor what acknowledged put we the role of conquest. Still be it yours. Bestow it at your pleasure. And believe, Caesar's no merchant to make prize of things that merchants sold. No, dear queen, for we intend so to dispose you as yourself shall give us counsel. Feed and sleep, for our care and pity so much upon you that we remain your friend. And so, adieu.
My master and my lord.
Not so. Adieu.
He words me, girls, he words me, that I should not be noble to myself. But hark thee, Carmion.
Finish, good lady. The bright day is done, and we are for the dark.
Hie thee again. I have spoke already, and it is provided. Go put it to the haste.
Madam, I will.
Madam, it is hereto sworn by your command, which my love makes religion to obey.
I tell you this, Caesar through Syria intends his journey, and within 3 days you with your children will he send before. Make your best use of this. I have performed your pleasure in my promise.
Dolabella, I shall remain your debtor.
I, your servant. Adieu, good queen. I must attend on Caesar.
Farewell, and thanks. Now, Iris, what think'st thou? Thou, an Egyptian puppet, shall be shown in Rome as well as I. Mechanic slaves with greasy aprons, rules, and hammers shall uplift us to the view. In their thick breaths, rank of gross diet, shall we be enclouded and forced to drink their vapor.
The gods forbid!
Nay, that's certain. Saucy lictors will catch at us like strumpets, and scald rhymers belt us out of tune. The quick comedians extemporally will stage us and present our Alexandrian revels. Antony shall be brought drunken forth, and I will see some squeaking Cleopatra buoy my greatness in the posture of a whore.
Oh, the good God!
Nay, that's certain.
I'll never see it, for I'm sure my nails are stronger than mine eyes.
Why, that's the way to fool their preparation and conquer their most absurd intent. Now, Carmion. Show me my women like a queen. Get my best attires. I am again for Sidness to meet Mark Antony. Sir Iris, go.
Now, noble Carmion, perform but this one chair, and thou wilt have leave then to play till doomsday. Bring our crown and all. Wherefore's this noise?
Here is a rural fellow who will not be denied your highness' presence. He brings you figs.
Let him come in. Poor an instrument may do a noble deed. He brings me liberty. My resolution's placed, and I have nothing of woman in me. Now, from head to foot, I am marble constant, and the fleeting moon no planet is of mine.
This is the man.
Avoid and leave him. Hast thou the pretty worm of Nihilus there that kills and pains not?
Truly, I have him, but I would not be the party that should desire you to touch him, for his biting is immortal. Those that do die of it do seldom or never recover.
Rememberest thou any that have died on?
Very many, men and women too. I heard of one of them no longer than yesterday. A very honest woman, but something given to lie, as a woman should not do, but in the way of honesty. How she died of the biting of it, what pain she felt, truly she makes a very good report of the worm. But he that shall believe all that they say shall never be saved by half that they do. But this is most valuable. The worm's an odd worm.
Get thee gone, farewell.
I wish you all joy of the worm.
Farewell.
You must think this, look ye, that worm will do his kind.
Aye, aye, farewell.
Look ye, that worm is not to be trusted but in the keeping of wise people, for indeed there is no goodness in the worm.
Have thou no care, it shall be heeded.
Give it nothing, I pray you, for it is not worth the feeding.
Will it eat me?
You must not think that I am so simple, but I know the devil himself will not eat a woman. I know that a woman is a dish for the gods, if the devil dress her not. But in these same horse and devils do the gods great harm in their women, for in every 10 that they make, the devils mar 5.
Get thee hence, farewell.
Yes, forsooth, I wish you all joy in the worm.
Give me my robe. Put on my crown. I have immortal longings in me. Now no more the juice of Egypt's grape shall moist this lip. Yeah, yeah, good Iris, quick. Methinks I hear Antony call and rouse himself to praise my noble act and mock the luck of Caesar, which the gods give men to excuse their after wrath. Husband, I come. Now to that name my courage prove my title. I am fire and air. My other elements I give to baser life. So, have you done? Come then, and take the last warmth of my lips. Farewell, kind Carmion. And Iris, long farewell. Have I the aspic in my lips? Dost fall? If thou and nature may so gently part, the stroke of death is as a lover's pinch which hurts and is desired. Dost thou lie still? Thus thou vanishest, thou tellest the world it is not worth leave-taking.
Dissolve the cloud and rain, that I may say the gods themselves do weep.
This proves me base. If first she meet the curled Antony, he'll make demand of her, and spend that kiss which is my heaven to have. Come, thou mortal wretch. With thy sharp teeth, this knot intrinsicate of life at once untie. Poor venomous fool, be angry and dispatch. Oh, couldst thou speak, that I might hear thee call great Caesar ass unpolished.
Oh, Eastern star!
Peace, peace. Dost not thou see my baby at my breast that sucks the nurse's sleep?
Break! Oh, prince!
Sweet as balm, as soft as air,
as gentle, oh, Antony, I shall take thee to, what should I stay?
In this vile world. So, fare thee well. Now boast thee death. In thy possession lies, alas, unparalleled. Downy windows, clothes, and golden Phoebus never be beheld of eyes again so royal. Your crown's awry. I'll mend it, and then play.
Where is the queen?
Speak softly. Wake her not.
Well, Caesar hath sent
too slow a messenger. Oh, come apace, dispatch. I partly feel thee.
Approach, ho, all is not well. Caesar's beguiled.
There's Dolabella sent from Caesar, I'll call him.
What work is this, Carmion? Is it well done?
It is well done, and fitting for a princess descended of so many royal kings. Ah, soldier.
Caesar, thy thoughts touch their effects in this. Thyself art coming to see performed the dreaded act which thou so soughtst to hinder.
Wait there, wait for Caesar.
Oh, sir, you are too sure an augurer. That you did fear is done.
Bravest at the last, she leveled at our purposes, and being royal, took her own way.
Oh, Caesar, this Carmion lived but now. She stood and spake. I found her trimming up the diadem on a dead mistress. Tremblingly she stood, then on the sudden dropped.
She looks like sleep, as she would catch another Antony in her strong toil of grace. She will be buried by her Antony. No grave upon the earth shall clip in it a pair so famous. High events as these strike those that make them. And their story is no less in pity than his glory who brought them to be lamented. Our army shall in solemn show attend this funeral and then to Rome. Come, Dolabella, see high order in this great solemnity.